thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be.
Good morning and welcome to Ballysally Presbyterian Church Online. We're delighted to have you worshiping with us this morning, whether you're a member of our own congregation or joining us from another congregation. It's great to have you with us. And I hope you, like me, have been enjoying the signs of spring that have been developing all around us, and for the lighter nights that enable us to get out for a wee bit longer, maybe on our afternoon walk. It's lovely just to see what the Lord is doing in these days. And it's lovely, too, to have the sense that God is continuing to work despite all of the restrictions that we've been experiencing, that he's not hindered or held back in any way by these things. And so we rejoice in that great truth, that God continues to do his work unsurprised, not taken aback by any of the changes that at times rock us back on our heels. We've come together, as we've said this morning, to worship. And the psalmist says, "You, O Lord, are compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness." And we come to our gracious and compassionate God now as we sing a hymn that we've just been getting used to, "You're a Good and Gracious King." Let's all sing.
Securing you forever, to the King in need of nothing. Empty-handed I rejoice. You deserve the greater glory. Overcome with joy I sing. By your love I am accepted.
That's great singing, I'm presuming. I love this song, one of my new favourites. We'll be singing it again, hopefully in due course. We're going to continue to worship now as we unite our hearts in prayer. Let's all pray. God, our Heavenly Father, as we approach you this morning, we're conscious that you are a King, the King of Kings. You're seated on your throne, glorious and majestic. You are God Almighty, strong beyond compare, perfect in holiness, loving in all you do. And we come to you this morning as we come every time, empty-handed. We've nothing to offer you, nothing that's worthy of your love, nothing that's in keeping with your holiness, nothing that would make us attractive to you in any way. And yet we come rejoicing, rejoicing because of your promise of acceptance. We've no reason for confidence in coming to you except that you've invited us to come. And you have assured us that we're accepted in Jesus Christ. Accepted as friends by the friend of sinners. Adopted as children by a loving Heavenly Father. You're a good and gracious King. We delight in your kindness and mercy. We marvel at your goodness and grace. We worship you, our Savior King. And we come again to you, the King in need of nothing. We come empty-handed, but rejoicing. Forgive us our many sins, known and unknown, thoughtless or deliberate, sins of omission as well as commission. Lord, we've sinned against you in thought and word and deed, and we're sorry. We put our hope in the death of Jesus who died in our place, and trust in his redeeming blood to make us clean. Accept us in your Son, Lord. Fill us with your Spirit. Be our burden bearer and give us your strength, because you're our good and gracious King. And Lord, send us out into your world to live for your glory, to serve your purposes, and to follow your Son as faithful disciples. And we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I want to just remind you that we're meeting by Zoom on Wednesday night at 8 o'clock for the next installment of our Bible study series in 1 Thessalonians. We had a really good first night last week, a good number of people attending, and a really positive and helpful experience. I'm sure there are a number of you who could still be a part of that, and I want to invite you and to encourage you to come along and join with us. A great opportunity to read God's Word together, to think about what it means for us in our day, and at this stage in our lives. So that's Wednesday at 8 o'clock by Zoom. And then to remind you that Kids Club is back on Thursday at 6:30 with a new series, Breaking News. And I want to encourage all the boys and girls to come and be a part of that. And you parents and guardians, if you have influence, use that influence to make this part of your weekly routine. There are craft packs for the series. They're being distributed through Ballysally Primary School, and we thank the school for helping us with that. But if you wouldn't be receiving one through the school, we do have others available. If you let us know, we'll make sure that you get one for your kids. So that's Thursday at 6:30. And then on Friday at 7 o'clock, our SALT program for the young people continues. And again, can I encourage all you young people to get involved? It's a really great opportunity to spend some time together and to think about God's Word and how it applies in the lives of young people today. That's all our announcements. We're going to ask Lewis to come now and share with the boys and girls. Lewis.
Hi, boys and girls. How are you? Today, I want to ask you a question. What is the greatest story ever? Have a wee chat with your mum and dad or whoever's looking after you and have a wee discussion about what is the greatest story ever. I'm going to give you 10 seconds. Okay, maybe you've had a discussion. Maybe it's a TV show like Paw Patrol, or one when I was growing up was Power Rangers. Maybe it's a movie like Toy Story or Finding Nemo, or maybe you're going old-fashioned. Maybe it's a book. Maybe it's the Hungry Caterpillar, or Guess How Much I Love You, or maybe it's Narnia. Well, I've got some books today, and some of these books are amazing stories. We have The Little Puppy, the story of a puppy who got lost and needed to be found. That's our first one. Our second one is Aesop's Fables. It's a story of all the different animals and how the animals get along. And the main character is Aesop the turtle. Amazing story. I got this story. This was a Christmas present, actually. And this story is called Lewis Saves Christmas. Graham Todd and Rachel Todd got me this story. An amazing story. I'll even lend it to you if you want. But this here is probably one of my favorite stories. This is a children's Bible. And actually, I didn't get this when I was a baby or when I was a child. I got this when I was much older. And I love it because it has loads and loads of stories from the Bible. Stories about a boy called David who defeated a giant. Stories of a man called Jonah who was told to go to another city and in some way or another ended up in the belly of a fish. It has a story about a man called Jesus who lived in this earth, and he healed people. He healed this man one day, and he told him to get up. The man couldn't walk, and when Jesus said, get up, he was able to walk. Amazing stories. Maybe some of the most amazing stories you've ever heard are from the Bible. And they're not all these stories, they're not just all individual stories. All these stories are part of one big story. And so this story is God's great big story. All the tiny stories that you've heard over the years all are part of this one big plan that was set out by God. The Bible tells us that the Word of God is living. The Bible tells us the Word of God is true. And so all these tiny stories are true, and they all piece together to be this one big story that all point to one thing. The Bible tells us about how God is faithful to us. How God was faithful even when we weren't. When we messed up, God still loved us. And it all points us to one person. That person is called Jesus. And from the beginning of the Bible to the end, God had a rescue plan for us. Have you ever gone on a walk or you've went on a drive and maybe mummy and daddy have got lost and you don't know where you are? What is the one thing you look for? Well, when I get lost, what I try to look for are signposts. I try to find signs that point me in the right direction. And the whole way through the Bible, there's all these wee tiny signposts all in all the stories that point us towards Jesus, that point us towards our Savior. And boys and girls, over the next few weeks, that's what we're going to be doing. We're going to be taking a journey from the very beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible. And we're going to be looking at how all of this points to Jesus and how it's all one great big story. We're going to be talking about creation. We're going to be talking about God saving his people. We're going to be talking about kings and queens. We're going to be talking about all these amazing stories, and we're going to see how they all fit into God's great big story. This story didn't finish in the Bible. This story actually includes us. And we play a part in it. God didn't finish it when the Bible ended. This story means something to us today. And so when we look at it, we're going to be looking at how it can mean something and it can apply to us today as well. Over the next number of weeks, I'm going to go and get something. Over the next number of weeks, we're going to be looking at all these amazing stories, and we're going to see how God has been working out his amazing plan. And I know that seems a bit crazy. I know that seems hard, and there's loads of stuff to get through. And so we've got something for you. We have got this lovely book. This is the God's Great Big Story workbook. And you're going to begin this over the next week. And you're going to have it for next week. And in it, there's going to be explanations of the stories. There's going to be some puzzles. There's going to be places for you to color in and to draw. And right in the middle is my favorite thing. In the middle of this book, there's a timeline. And it's going to show us all the stories we're going to be looking at and where they play in God's great big story. So over the next week, you're going to be getting this. And it's going to be handed out to you. So keep an eye out for it. If you don't get one, get mommy or daddy to give us a call and send us a text, and we will get you one as soon as possible. Boys and girls, this big story means something to us today. This big story is amazing. And so we want to thank God for it. And so we're going to take time now to pray and to thank God for this story. So everyone's going to shake their hands, get all the jiggles out, and we're going to put our hands together. Stops us from fidgeting. We're going to close our eyes because it keeps us to pay attention. And we're going to talk to God. Father God, we thank you that all the stories in the Bible are part of your big story. They're all linked together and they all point towards Jesus. Father, help us over the next few weeks to understand that. And help us to understand that we play a part in that. That the story is part of our lives too. Father, be with us, keep us safe, and we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Boys and girls, we've got a new song for you. This new song is called All About Jesus, and it tells us about the story right from the beginning to the end, from Genesis to Revelation, and it tells us all about God's great big story. I'm going to stay up here, do the actions, and we're going to try and learn it together. So I want you to get up on your feet. Get the jiggles out again, and we're going to sing It's All About Jesus.
Every word is true. They were all breathed out by you. Your spirit wrote through men like a pen in the hand of a God who knew that we would need to know how much you love us. So you wrote it down for us forever. Oh, from Genesis to Revelation, there's one story of your great salvation. It's all about Jesus. Oh, it's all about Jesus. Shout now from every page, there's one hero that'll save the day. It's all about Jesus. Oh, it's all about Jesus. Like the sun that shines so bright, it leads us day by day to the one, the way, the truth, the light. And every time we read, you give us what we need to grow in grace and know you better. Oh, from Genesis to Revelation, there's one story of your great salvation. It's all about Jesus. Oh, it's all about Jesus.
Jesus. Even from Eden we read, the serpent will be crushed by a seed of Eve. Cause all glory belongs to the Son, every story pointing to the Holy One. Like when Abraham put Isaac on the altar, he pulled the knife, but God, he never falters. Faithful to his promise, he would provide a substitute ram for the sacrifice. And now, he gave commandments so we could see his holiness. And
our desperate need. There were so many temporary sacrifices. None of them were perfect, no, but Christ is. The prophet spoke and they were not liars. God would send his very own son to be Messiah. Rescue, redeem, restore, reclaim. Every saint loves his holy name. Cause he died on the cross to take our place. The final substitute and eternal grace. And he rose from the grave and up to the throne. Until he comes again to gather his own.
From Genesis to Revelation, there's one story of your great salvation. It's all about Jesus, so oh, it's all about Jesus. Shout now from every page, there's one hero that'll save the day. It's all about Jesus, so oh, it's all about Jesus.
It's all about Jesus.
Every word is true.
It's all about Jesus.
It's all breathed down by you.
It's all about Jesus.
One story.
It's all about Jesus.
It's all about Jesus.
It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus.
Thanks, Lewis. That was really brilliant. Kids, I wish you could have seen Lewis busting his moves there during the rap. It was just incredible. Maybe you'll get to see that whenever we're all back together again. Don't forget to look out for the booklets that you can follow along and for the little timeline, which will help you see the great big story as it unfolds. We're going to ask Graham to come and lead us now in our prayers for others. And then Josie's going to read to us from God's word. Graham.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning to say thank you. Thank you that when we walked away from you and went on our own way, you did not leave us, but had a plan to rescue us. Thank you that when the time was right, you sent Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you came and lived a perfect life, died on the cross to take the punishment for our sins, and restored our relationship with God. Thank you that you rose again so that we too may rise. Thank you, God, that you sent us your Holy Spirit to comfort, guide, and direct us each day of our lives. Thank you that you continue to speak to us through your word, the Bible. Father, we come to you today because your mercies are new every morning. We thank you that we can come to you as your children because Jesus is our perfect Savior. Thank you for taking our sins immeasurably far away from us. Father God, as you revealed yourself to Abraham in ancient days, we ask that you reveal yourself to us today. Make us into a faithful people who are ready to believe your promises and follow you wherever you may lead us. Father, we pray this morning for those who love you and who are suffering at this time. Many of us are concerned about family or people with underlying health conditions that make them more vulnerable to coronavirus. We pray for those who are currently in hospital or who are unwell. We pray for those in our community who don't have a family or those who feel alone because of these restrictions and who are finding this time so very difficult. Father God, send them your comfort, your peace, and your calming presence to those who are without hope today. Father, we pray for your blessing on this, your church, in this place and in this season, that the community of believers would be strengthened despite not being able to meet together. During this period of Lent, give us a new awareness of your presence in our church here in Ballysally and teach us the humility to accept that all our gifts come from you. We pray for wisdom for John, our pastor, and for the Kirk session as they meet to plan how we can return to church in a safe way. We pray that you would equip us in how to best serve you, unite us together as a body, that we would have unity in the faith and a deep knowledge of you. Thank you, God, that your gospel gives us such unity and as possible. We pray that our family here in Ballysally would grow in maturity to be more like you. We pray that when difficulties come our way, we will hold fast to your word and your teachings would remind us to remain confident and steadfast in you. We are sorry for our lack of trust because we are weak and sinful, but we are reminded in the song that we so often sing, your love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out on me. So we say thank you. We thank you for the churches across our world this morning that have been challenged to get amongst their communities because of the pandemic. We pray that they will be the hands and feet of Jesus in both prayer and action. Father, we pray for families in poorer countries where being in lockdown means no longer being able to feed their family, in places where malnutrition already is a problem, where more people are going hungry and face the risk of starvation. Father, we ask that you will have mercy and protect countries where there is a lack of basic provision or where there is devastation because of natural disasters or conflict. We pray for strength, wisdom and protection for all healthcare workers in this place. We pray for wisdom and support for governments of developing nations who can't provide a safety net for their people because of a lack of resources and fragile infrastructures. We pray for our local council here in Causeway, for our assembly in Stormont, and our civil service as they plan a roadmap to get us out of this current lockdown. We ask you, God, that you will give these leaders the ability to provide order, facilitate cooperation, and protect the vulnerable. We pray, God, that decisions that they will make will improve the well-being of your people and for our society. We pray that judgments made will be for the greater good and not for political favour or gain. Help us to pray for them as they make choices, many of which are unfavourable to so many at this time. Father, we pray for our moderator, the Reverend David Bruce, as he serves a second term in office. We pray for him and his wife, Zoe, as they plan to stay for this extended role and as he plans to visit and encourage our church more widely as restrictions ease. Father, tomorrow we see some children returning to school. We thank you for the gift of learning and for our school and nursery here in Ballysally. We pray for school life as it resumes again after months of lockdown and the long Christmas break. Be with our principals, cleaners and others who have responsibility in arrangements for the smooth running of the school day. Be with teachers and classroom assistants as they help pupils settle back into learning again. Be with parents, grandparents and carers as they gently help loved ones readjust to the return of school. Be with the children and young people as they renew relationships with staff and friends as they embrace new rhythms and routines in familiar places. Help them to pick up their work again, remembering what they have learned before. Father, be with those in crucial exam years, taking away fear of months of learning that's been lost. Father, be with them all. We pray for summer teams here in Ballysally and across our land as we make plans for summer outreach. We think of the work of Exodus here in Corian. We pray for plans to send teams across the UK to serve you, but unsure of how this will look. Give the young people and the leaders wisdom and clarity and the best way forward. We pray for Ethan, for his leadership and for his role as he works with team leaders and mentors them at this time. Finally, Lord, we bring before you all missionaries who serve you in a wide range of places across our world who need a touch of your love today. As support in these times are less than in normal days, we thank you that you haven't forgotten about them, even though some have slipped from our radar. Bless them as they teach, share, and apply the gospel of your grace. Father, you know their hearts and their needs. Meet your servants right where they're at today. Grant them a new perspective of eternity. Rekindle their hope and inspire your people to support them generously. We thank you, Father, that you are still on your throne and that you continue to build your church and that you are faithful to your promises. Give us strength to live as ambassadors for you. Feed our minds with your word. Fill our hearts with your love and empower our worship by your spirit. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
The reading this morning is from 1 Peter 4, verses 12 to 19, suffering for being a Christian. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice in as much as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed. For the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, Do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear his name. For it is time for judgment to begin with God's household. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and of the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. Amen.
Thank you, Josie and Graham and Lewis too. We really appreciate your ministry. And as we come to think about this message from 1 Peter chapter 4, let's ask for the Lord's help. God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this living word that you speak afresh to us today. We ask that you'd help us to understand, help us to grow in obedience and in commitment to living out what you're calling us to do. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as you can imagine, I've had an absolutely fantastic week. The Glens beat the Blues twice in 1 week. I certainly didn't see that coming. It was a huge but very welcome surprise. And what about the all-conquering Liverpool team from last season? Struggling to score, beaten by Brighton, Leicester and Everton, to mention but a few. Who thought that would happen? What a surprise. I have to say I've enjoyed that surprise too. And Britain's hugely successful COVID vaccine rollout has been a huge surprise too. None of us really saw that coming, I suspect. We didn't expect it to be so smooth and so efficient, but we're delighted by the surprise. It's very welcome. Many Christians are shocked and surprised in a very different way when they go through a time of hardship and suffering. We can become very unsettled, disorientated, bewildered, as if something very strange is happening. Our faith can be shaken to its core when hardship and suffering come, which is a bit odd when you think about it, since the Bible has so much to say about the hardship and suffering that Christians can expect to face. Peter's message here in chapter 4 is completely consistent with the rest of the Bible. Peter is in line with all of the Bible when he says to these churches in verse 12, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you're suffering, as though something strange were happening to you." The first thing that Peter says from this passage to them and to us is, don't be surprised by hardship and suffering. We all experience times of hardship and suffering because we live in a broken, sin-spoiled world. Sickness and bereavement, heartache and death are never far away from any of us. And of course, we bring hardship and suffering on ourselves because of our own stupidity or our own wrongdoing. Peter mentions that in verse 15 of this passage. But the suffering and hardship that Peter's thinking about, particularly in these verses, comes because we belong to Christ. It's the ridicule, alienation, exclusion, disadvantage, threats, intimidation, slander, and even violence and death that Christians suffer because of our love for Jesus and our service for Jesus. Look at verses 14 and 16. Peter says, "If you're insulted because of the name of Christ, you're blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer as a Christian," verse 16, "do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name." These Christians Peter's writing to have been going through a time of outright opposition and persecution, and it has really shaken them and discouraged them. And Peter here reminds them that there's nothing especially surprising or strange going on. The Bible's full of stories of how God's people were opposed and persecuted for their worship and service of him. Think of Moses and Pharaoh, Daniel in the lion's den, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, Jeremiah thrown down a well, and countless others too. Hebrews 11 refers to them when it says they were tortured, imprisoned, mocked, flogged, sawn in two, stoned, put to death by the sword. They were ill-treated, made destitute, and rendered homeless, all for love of the Lord. And remember, too, what the Lord Jesus himself said. Blessed are you when men hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Jesus said to his own disciples, they lay hands on you and persecute you. They will deliver you to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors, and all on account of my name. Peter says, don't be surprised when hardship and suffering come upon you because you're a follower of Jesus Christ. There's nothing strange or out of the ordinary or unexpected about that. That's how a world in rebellion against God often treats God's people. Compared with so many of God's people, we here in our situation suffer very little as a result of our following and serving the Lord. Brothers and sisters in many places are suffering greatly at this very moment. People imprisoned, people who've been bereaved, people who have been beaten and tortured because of their love for Jesus and their service of Jesus. We need to remember them. We need to pray for them. We need to do what we can to support them and be conscious that our suffering is very limited in terms of theirs. And yet we are still suffering, aren't we, as followers of Jesus Christ. We may be ridiculed or slandered. Increasingly, we may feel alienated or excluded from our society as it leaves behind its generally Christian worldview and morality. Christians in our society have experienced a great privilege for centuries now, but it feels like the times are changing. I was reading in the paper the other day an account of a situation in the United States and the expression of a point of view by some people. And the writer of the article said, why would we pay any heed to what these people are saying? These are the people who believe in Noah's Ark. We hear ever more regularly that Christians are against women, that they're denying a woman her right to decide what happens in her own body. We hear increasingly people say that Christians are promoting hate speech when they describe other people's life choices as sin. Our society is changing, and we may not like the changes we see developing around us. We may feel threatened by them, and we may well be working very hard to resist those changes. But Peter says we shouldn't be overly surprised, because hardship and suffering for Christ's sake are part and parcel of what it means to follow after Christ. Peter says, don't be surprised when hardship and suffering come. And he also says to rejoice in times of hardship and suffering. Peter says in verse 13, rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ. Now, that sounds a wee bit counterintuitive, doesn't it? Suffering isn't something that we usually associate with rejoicing. And yet that's what Peter is calling us to do. I suspect if we're really honest, we may think that what Peter is calling us to do is a bit daft. It's a bit silly to ask people to rejoice when they're going through hardship and suffering. It's a wee bit like the sign on the toilet door that says, toilet out of order, please use the floor below. Or the sign on the washing machine in the laundrette that says, please remove all your clothes when the light goes out. Or my favorite notice from a hotel in Spain. All the water in this hotel has been personally passed by the manager. What we're hearing sounds a wee bit odd to our ears. It sounds a bit unusual when Peter says, rejoice in times of hardship and suffering. There's something else going on here. We need to think into this. What does this actually mean? Well, Peter's not telling us to rejoice in the pain of hardship or suffering. He's not telling us that these things, by their very own nature, are good things. That's not what he's saying. And he's not saying that we will necessarily feel like rejoicing when we're experiencing hardship and pain. He's telling us that we must choose to rejoice when we enter into these kinds of experiences. We must exercise our own will, refuse to be governed by our feelings, and decide for ourselves how we're going to respond. Peter calls us, in the face of suffering, to choose to rejoice. And he gives us some good reasons on which we can base our rejoicing. He says in verse 13, "Rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed." He says we should rejoice because we're part of what Christ is doing. We're caught up in the sufferings of Christ. We participate in the sufferings of Christ. Not in the sense that we add in any way to the atonement that Christ makes for sin through his suffering. But caught up with Christ and participating in the sufferings of Christ in the sense that we are identifying with Christ. That we're following in the footsteps of the Lord Jesus. That we're living according to the pattern of Jesus, who for the joy set before him endured the cross and scorned its shame. The suffering of Jesus one day gives way to the glory of Jesus, and we are caught up in that pattern that Jesus has established for us. One day, as we suffer for Christ, we will be caught up into his glory too. And is that not a reason to rejoice? That as we suffer for Christ's sake, we're identified with Christ. We're part of Christ. We're following in his footsteps. We're part of his amazing rescue plan. And that the Christ who suffered and then entered into his glory will lead us through our suffering to share in his glory on the last day. A glorious reason to rejoice. But in the midst of heartache and suffering, we have to make the mental connections and choose to rejoice. Choose not to focus on how we're feeling. Choose not to focus on the pain we're experiencing. Choose not to identify with the real loss that we're going through. But instead, while not ignoring that or forgetting that or denying that, to turn our attention to what is ours in our relationship with Christ. Because we're suffering with Christ, caught up in the sufferings of Christ. And then look at verse 14. Peter says, if you're insulted because of the name of Christ, you're blessed, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. Peter says we're blessed when we suffer for Jesus' sake, because the presence and the work of God's Spirit in us, because of the presence of and the work of God's Spirit in us and on us. Peter's repeating what Jesus had said to him previously. Jesus said, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. We can rejoice when we suffer for Christ's sake now, because the Holy Spirit is using our experience to make us more like Jesus. Because the Spirit of God is using those difficulties and challenges to shape us into the likeness of Jesus, to bring us closer to the Lord and to make us more like him in the way we live out our lives. We can rejoice that our faithfulness to the Lord now, in the face of great suffering, will one day be wonderfully rewarded in glory. And is that not a reason for rejoicing? That even though we're experiencing difficulty and hardship, pain and loss, it's serving the purposes of God in our lives to make us more like Jesus, to fit us for heaven, and to earn for us a glorious reward one day. And as Peter says these things, he's not simply pontificating. He's not speaking theoretically. This is the Peter who knows all about this from personal experience. Remember how in Acts 5, when Peter was preaching the gospel, he was arrested and put in prison with some of the other apostles. And they were intimidated and interrogated, and they were commanded not to speak in the name of Jesus. They were flogged and sent out to refrain from preaching about Jesus. And in verse 41 of Acts chapter 5, it says, the apostles left the Sanhedrin, rejoicing because they'd been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. Peter knows what he's talking about. He has experienced personally suffering for Jesus' sake. And he has experienced personally the rejoicing that's possible in the midst of that suffering. When we focus on not simply our suffering, but also the glory it's achieving. To be counted worthy to suffer for Christ is a reason to rejoice. To be shaped by our suffering into the greater likeness of Jesus is a reason to rejoice. To remember that one day this suffering will fall away and the gates of glory will open and we'll be welcomed in to receive the glorious reward that God has prepared for his people. Is that not a reason to rejoice? Of course it is. Peter says to us, rejoice when you enter into hardship and suffering for Christ's sake. And then finally in this passage, Peter says, commit yourself to the Lord in times of hardship and suffering. Look at verse 19. Peter says, so then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. When we understand that hardship and suffering are a normal, everyday part of what it means to follow Jesus, then we can more easily accept it. And when we see what it accomplishes in us and through us, we can more easily rejoice in it. But hardship and suffering are still difficult. They're still painful. There's still real loss to come to terms with. Peter does not in any way diminish the reality of the hardship or the suffering. He doesn't pretend that it doesn't happen. He doesn't say that it doesn't matter. He doesn't say that you'll not feel it. He recognizes that we need the help of our faithful Creator God to endure it. He points us back then to the God who's able to comfort and strengthen us. The one who made us knows how we feel. The one who sustains us day by day and gives us our very breath is the one whose grace is sufficient to enable us to overcome in the struggle which is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. God's mighty power, the Creator's power, is able to deliver us so that we're able to come safely home to glory at God's appointed time. There'll be times when we're delivered out of suffering, and there'll be times when we're delivered in the midst of suffering, and there'll be times when we're brought safely home, perhaps as a result of persecution. But God is able in all these circumstances to equip us to live for his glory, to stand firm and to stand true, so that we feel no shame from social exclusion. Remember, this is written to people in a shame culture. We'll not be ashamed, even if we're regarded as fools or haters, because we're equipped by the Spirit of the living God. And that one Creator God who's able to sustain us and bring us safely through the day of judgment has begun that judgment process in our day. Judgment begins at the house of God. Judgment begins when people are shaped and molded and purified and refined in the heat of struggle and hardship. We experience God's judgment, but not condemnation, as he exposes our sin and helps us to deal with it in the power of his Spirit. And although these things are difficult and challenging for us, although it's hard to experience this level of discipline, judgment, evaluation, reshaping, Peter reminds us that that's nothing compared to what those will go through who have no Savior, who will be condemned, and who will feel in themselves the full weight of the wrath of God. There's a day coming when the people of God will be revealed and ushered into their reward. And on that same day, those who have rejected God's love and mercy and kindness, those who've turned their backs on God's invitation, call, and plead to come to Him, will get their wish and will depart from Him forever. Forever cut off from His love and kindness and mercy, and instead bearing only His awful wrath against sin. So you and me who belong to Christ, though it's tough at times, let's rejoice that we have a Savior who will bring us safely home. And for those who don't yet know that Savior, whose destiny is lost forever, please remember that Jesus, the friend of sinners, opens wide His arms and says to you, come to Me and find your hope in Me. Accept from Me the forgiveness that I can provide. Accept Me as the one who will save you and lead you by the hand out of darkness into God's eternal day. Today, if you don't know Jesus as Savior, He invites you to come to Him and put your hope in Him. Ask Him to save you, to be your strength, to be your joy, to be your hope, while there's still time to do that. Let's pray. God, our Heavenly Father, we thank You for this message from Peter, who knows all about what it's like to suffer for Christ's sake. Thank You for the leadership and guidance and direction that he gives us. Help us to hear what he's saying, to hear You speak through him, and to heed what's being said, so that we find great joy and fullness and life forevermore. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. These are very challenging words from Peter. If you're not sure how to respond, if you want to talk to me about them, if you want to ask some questions or find out more, please don't be afraid to get in touch. Make contact with us through our YouTube channel or our Facebook page, and we'd be glad to have a chat with you about these things. We're going to conclude our service now as we sing, Hear the Call of the Kingdom. Let's hear what the Lord is saying to us and rise up joyfully to respond. Let's commit our way to the Lord. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you today and remain with you forevermore. Amen. Have a great week. Rejoice that you belong to Jesus.
Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power through.